Now, Ms. Yamini Aiyar, please.
Thank you. I thought I'll step away from the statistics and try and give a sort of broader perspective on this budget, both from its political implications and, I think, even more importantly, its long-term institutional implications going forward. The politics is important. The politics is important, particularly this year, because while all eyes and ears, at least of everyone in this room, was on the television watching FM make his speech, something else equally critical was going on in Rajasthan in the bipole elections. And the bipole elections matter only because it clearly tells us that the political field is opening up somewhat. I think last year at this time, there may have been a different sense within the country, but that's changing. And because that's changing, it's important to try and understand what the government's response and reaction is, and what the particular political vulnerabilities are, and what this budget signals in that particular context. Everybody, the day after the budget, as Mr. Mozumdar said as well, highlighted that this is a budget for the elections. What was paid, less attention was paid to what precisely was the message in that budget speech. Everyone before me has also mentioned the difference between what was said in the speech and what was said in the numbers. I have to give Mr. Jaitley some credit. Almost every budget I have ever looked at, and I've been looking at them for years, you see this disparity always. So it's not particularly unique to this particular budget. It's perhaps more pronounced in this budget, but usually there's a lot of bluster in the budget speeches, and anybody that bothers to look through the fine print and actually get to the expenditure budget will see that there's a lot of talk and relatively less action in comparison. But I think in this particular case, the talk was important because hidden in that talk was a very clear message about the political failure and what we are likely to see in the next year in the run-up to 2019 and as these eight state elections are going to be confronting public debate going forward. And the message is this, that within about the first two paragraphs, you heard very little about the jobs, you heard very little about Skill India, you heard very little about Make in India, you heard very little about the narrative of aspiration, which in many ways was a political plank of this government when it came forward. And in 2014, a lot of effort was spent trying to make a very important distinction between what this particular political configuration was doing compared with the past by saying that we are the government of empowerment, not the government of entitlement. By saying that we are the government of poverty elimination, not of poverty alleviation. So there was an attempt to try and craft a new narrative of politics, a new narrative of the future. But in essence, what this budget, and frankly this has been crafted over the last few years as well, but in this budget it's even more pronounced, offers is in fact silence on the narrative of aspiration, and in many ways a lot of noise about on the narrative of entitlement. It's all about schemes. It's a slightly different coming together of schemes, but it is all about schemes. It is about sanitation, it is about housing, it is about Ujwala, which is a sort of new big push that we are seeing, and it is about the new showstopper in the form of health. But it's all about this coming together of schemes. It's not about the original narrative of empowerment, job skills, Make in India, Skill India, Stand Up India, and whatever new slogan was being projected in the early years of this government. And I think this emphasis on schemes also puts them in a slightly awkward conundrum. And the political conundrum is this: good, bad, ugly, whether by design or by accident, even in 2014 when the UPA went to the polls much weakened compared to 2009, there was still a political narrative around rights, welfare, and sort of building of a welfare state that they could construct and they could offer. For the moment, that new narrative is still not clear, I think, for this government. So you see schematic emphasis. And that schematic emphasis means that essentially you'll get a lot of bluster and noise around achievements of each of these schemes. But that comes to the next conundrum: they don't have the money. If you look at what the FM promises in his speech, right, we still have to build 1.88 crore toilets, we have to build 51 lakh new houses in rural India, and you start looking at the fine print of the budget. For the first time since this government came into power, Swachh Bharat Grameen stays more or less static, actually at a 9% drop in allocation if you compare it with revised estimates of last year. Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, same problem. Now, I personally am quite happy that we're not putting more money into Swachh Bharat Grameen, because I think the way in which it has evolved, it's become much more of a toilet construction program that is going to give us far more greater public health problems than we had anticipated and that we had even before 2014, but that's a different point. The real issue here is that they don't actually have the financial space, the fiscal space, to be able to invest in the way in which they would like, to even showcase the schemes that they have. And the goals are high, the bluster is high, leaving a big, wide open gap between what they're saying they're going to do and what they're actually going to be able to do, which from the perspective of political rhetoric, I think, is going to give us a lot of noise. A lot of emphasis on this new notion of ease of living rather in addition to an ease of business. We won't talk about the ease of business, I think, today, but regardless, the ease of living isn't quite going to give us, I think, in practice, for any practical change. And there will be a lot of bluster around the ease of living with a lot of statistical jugglery going forward, but a big gaping hole in the political narrative. One of the really interesting things that this budget is trying to do, and it's worth spending a little bit of time on this, is that it's pursuing, and I think previous budgets and previous governments too, but in particular this government, and this budget most importantly, focusing very hard, I think, on initiating an important architectural change in the architecture of public service delivery in India. I think it's very important for us to recognize this and talk a little bit about it. It's most visible in the context of the Ayushman Bharat, the National Health Insurance, the Health Protection Scheme. A lot has been said about what we can learn from past experiences with health insurance. A lot of questions are being asked about whether public-private is the right way to go. A lot of questions being asked about primary versus tertiary, what is the right way to go. It's worth debating all of these things. But very clearly, from the perspective of this government, if you just look at the fine print of the numbers, there is no significant increase in allocation for NHPS, certainly, as has been commented on in the last few days. But there is quite an interesting drop in allocations in the National Health Mission. So the National Health Mission has more or less remained static with about a 2% drop, but 30% of funds that were allocated for reproductive child health, which is a very important component of National Health Mission, which is the focus for primary care, for the central government, has seen a significant drop, clearly signaling that there is a commitment to thinking about a much more moving us in the direction of this sort of an insurance-based health system. Now, health has been largely ignored by successive governments for yonks. So in many ways, it's a very good thing that the conversation on health has finally come front and center and that the country is finally going to be able to leverage off this budget and debate some of these questions. But hidden here is an important architectural issue that we need to talk about. And the architectural issue is this. It seems like this government is clearly committing the service delivery for India in the direction away from provision towards regulation. It's very clear. If you look across all schemes as well, even the big push towards technology, it's trying to create an architecture where the state's role will be less one of providing and more one of regulation. Now, we can argue whether this is the right way to go or not, but that is an important thing to consider. Can a state that has failed so miserably to even do some of the most basic provision things have within it, without significant investments in state capacity, the ability to do something as complicated and complex as regulation? Just take health insurance. To get this right, you need to think about pricing, you need to think about quality standards, you need to think about monitoring, you need to think about enforcement mechanisms. Where is this capacity? Have you even begun to think about it? Think about RSBY and some of the state health schemes. We did some quick searches to try and understand just simple things, manpower. RSBY is manned in single digits in the ministry in Delhi. In a state like Bihar, a quick phone call told us that there are about 10, between 7 to 10 staff, and the nodal officer holds additional charge. You cut across, all across the state, it's mostly in single digits, with some exceptions of the trust that the states, for insurance programs that states are running, which have about 100 to 200 employees. Think about Thailand, 1,500 employees. The US federal government agency handling Medicare, Mediclaim, 6,000 employees. Just the numbers of people that you need to get something as complex as this done right, we simply don't have. And we have no administrative budget to get this done. So what we are doing instead is relying on insurers, third parties, to perform a lot of the important tasks related to building awareness, enrollment, monitoring, enforcement, et cetera. And we don't have within the state the sophistication, skills, and capability, plus the manpower, to be able to even monitor what is being outsourced to third-party agencies and so on. We think the solution to this problem lies in IT. Well, let's look at RSBY, a very sophisticated database. Yet there's been very little analytical work within the government to even look at claims data to try and understand what hospital quality standards look like. Most countries use claims data. It's a critical thing that they use. There's been very little, absolutely no, in fact, analysis within government. A very few pieces of analysis outside of government, and those that have bothered to look at the data will be quick to point out that the quality of data is so poor because even private hospitals don't have trained administrators to do basic data entry. A CAG report on Kerala tells us that impaneled hospitals are awaiting 12.5 crores worth of reimbursement funds. And one of the reasons why they're not getting that 12.5 crores is because of loss of data and data errors in the online system on the basis of which claims are put and reimbursements are provided. So these very, very basic systems that we need to have in place to push a state to move in the direction of doing something as sophisticated as regulation, we haven't got. We need to debate what a regulatory architecture could look like, but there's a precursor to that, which is actually fixing some of these basics. And that fix of basics requires serious capacity investment. That capacity investment also is financial. And so there is this question, where is the money going to come from? I would be quite comfortable with low allocations in all the centrally sponsored schemes and all social sector schemes if we committed ourselves to actually filling basic vacancies and providing high quality training to our public administrators. Just that will see a huge improvement in the quality of public services and will completely change the architecture of our service delivery. We may then actually be able to have a serious conversation about where does provision make most sense and where does regulation make most sense, rather than make the assumption as we're doing now that simply bypassing the state without investing in it at all is going to help us solve these very, very, very complex problems. The problem, another important issue, eligibility determination. All our programs are focused on mostly not universal. Eligibility determination is crucial. We are moving in an interesting direction by moving away from BPL lists towards SECC data as the criteria for identifying eligibility. But this is quite complicated too. Shreyana Bhattacharya of the World Bank might be here. She and I did some work on the PMAY last year, where they were using the SECC data for distribution of PMAY benefits. One of the most basic issues there, overall it was a much better system, but one of the most basic issues there was that of updation of the data, of the eligibility criteria. This was handed over to the Gram Panchayats, who were supposed to go out and do this. Gram Panchayat after Gram Panchayat kept saying, can you just take this away from us? It's a huge headache. The reason it's a headache is they don't have the staff. The reason it's a headache is they don't actually have any capability to handle claims and to handle the dispute resolution that is required in something like this. And they don't have the IT skills. So while you may say this is all online, it's all being filled on pieces of paper, and someone sitting in a block office is taking that piece of paper and putting it into a database, but there's no electricity, and so it's going to take another 5 days for this for that problem to be solved. So these are, I mean, just simple things. You need to staff better to be able to get these simple things done. You need to train better in order for local officers to be able to handle fairly complex dispute resolution around entitlements in this way. And if you compare this with how social registries have been set up all across the world, you'll find huge amounts of investments in human resources being placed at different places within the system to be able to get things done. So I think we are living in a complete fool's paradise. If we assume that architectural changes can be made without any investments and hard and serious investments in state capacity, and that I think is a cardinal error that this government has made. Previous governments have made this too. In fact, I think the opposition's response to the health insurance was quite intriguing because they were partly, it's not a bad idea, but we've got to oppose the government, so we have to think of things to say. What they ought to have said was, how on earth are we going to get this done? We don't have people, and we too didn't put the people in the system in the first place. The second important architectural issue, which speakers before me have brought up as well, which I think is worth commenting on too in the in this context, that of decentralization. One of the rationales that have been offered for why investments at the central government in social sectors have dropped over time, and as we saw in the data that Shanti presented, you are seeing a significant change, is because there's been this big push to decentralize to states. Now, as a votary of greater decentralization, I couldn't ask for anything more. I will be very comfortable if Delhi shuts down and leaves it to the states to get on with this business. It makes imminent sense in a country as large as India. It's the right political thing to do, and from an efficiency point of view, it's the right thing to do too. However, Delhi hasn't shut down. Delhi stayed going, the line ministries are still there, and the centrally sponsored schemes, which are really the bane of the entire architecture of financing social programs, are still very much around, functioning in exactly the same way as you would as they did in previous with previous finance commissions. This government set up the Niti Aayog on the promise of cooperative federalism. And the first thing that the Niti Aayog did, which I think was a very, very important step forward, was to set up a chief minister's subcommittee to figure out how to reform these centrally sponsored schemes. You couldn't have asked for a more sensible and politically savvy move. Bring the chief ministers in, they all complain, get them to figure out what's the best thing to do. They came up with a fair amount of somewhat reasonable recommendations, including very simple things that don't really break the status quo, just give 25% flexibility in all of these schemes and let states invest in the way that they want. Scheme after scheme after scheme after scheme, you basically functioning exactly as you were before. Clever accounting, clever budgeting. So you've reduced the centrally sponsored schemes from the 125 odd that they were in 2015 down to 30 because you created umbrella schemes, but the line items for each of these schemes still remain. The schemes themselves still exist. MHRD announced in the run-up to the budget that they were going to do the very sensible thing of merging Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan and the Secondary Education Program, RMSA, but they still come as two separate line items with two separate budgets. So in all practical purposes, it's exactly as it was. National Health Mission went from being a program for flexibility to a program with 2,000 line items on which states have to plan and report. So we are exactly as centralized as we were in the past. But even more importantly, because of the emphasis on schemes that has increased over the last 2 years, particularly, on the ground, you'll find district and block administration are not implementing state priorities given their low capacity. They are doing Swachh Bharat, they are doing Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, and they are doing Ujwala. These are the messages they've been given. In many ways, for all the talk of cooperative federalism, this government is in some senses even more centralized than previous regimes, because at some level, the loud rhetoric means that there's a lot of push. What is your target for Swachh Bharat? District magistrates are busy doing video conferences with the Prime Minister's office reporting on the targets. Well, if I were a district magistrate, I would only focus on Swachh Bharat and forget everything else. It makes sense. It's a rational thing to do. So the entire agenda of cooperative federalism, I think, has really slowed down, very limited progress. And in this, it's important also to say it's not just the government of India's fault. States, too, have played a really complicated double game, asking for more flexibility, but the minute they got the flexibility, struggling hard to want to get back the funds that they were getting through centrally sponsored schemes. Line department officials find it much easier to be wrapped on the knuckles by line department officials in the government of India than their own finance departments, because those negotiations are difficult. The finance departments arguing, and politicians too, actually, much to my surprise, arguing that we will spend a lot more on infrastructure where kickbacks are high and visibility is high and far less on social sectors, so we need these centrally sponsored schemes. You're suddenly back to square one. And I think one important reason for that goes back to the capacity issue. We haven't actually considered over years, as centralization became the dominant mechanism by which finances were provided, planning capacity at the state level has been completely decimated. We got rid of the planning commission, set up Niti Aayog, but we never talked about what is it going to take to build planning capacity at the state level to really be able to look forward and use the resources that they have got through the 14th Finance Commission effectively, efficiently, and sensibly in a way that would actually give states flexibility. So now what's going to happen, if you read between the lines on the NHPS, states have to put in about 4,000 crores. If you look, at least from some budget calculations that we've done, taking into account all the extra money that states still have to put in from their untied funds into centrally sponsored schemes, they have somewhere between 2,000 to 4,000 crores left for them to play with. They'll probably have to put all of that into NHPS. So much for centralization. And of course, local governments have got the worst end of the stick. Raja talked about municipal governments. I'd like to point out that rural local governments are being burdened as implementing agents for Swachh Bharat, for Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, to clean up SACC databases. But at no point has any effort been made to strengthen their capacities. The economic survey points out very rightly, not only do they have low revenue raising powers, the few revenue raising powers that they have, they are not able to use very effectively. There's a larger political economy story there, which I won't get into here. But one important part of that is they don't actually have bill collectors. The bill collectors they have are at best one for a population of 6,000 to 7,000. Assessments, collection, chasing up, putting all of this online because all systems have to be online now is a huge task for which only one official is simply not good enough. And that official is not doing just one thing, but also doing all the other programs that are being burdened onto the panchayat. So strengthening the panchayat, the 14th Finance Commission pushed a bunch of money down to directly to gram panchayat. Line ministries at the state and central government decided that's not a good thing, so they must make a gram panchayat plan. It's a good idea to make a gram panchayat plan if you have the capacity to plan, but most importantly, to make a plan, you need to at least have a sense of what your budget is within a panchayat, and there is no information on that either. So in essence, we've ended up with some very important potential architectural changes that need to be debated, and the emphasis needs to come back on state capacity. Some really important architectural changes that were initiated since 2015 that could have seen significant changes in the architecture of finances and the relationship between center and states over these last few years, where very limited progress has been made. Steps could have been taken, like the Finance Commission's suggestion that an institutional mechanism being set up to negotiate between center and states for centrally sponsored schemes. That could have been set up and things may have looked different. Essentially, the more things have changed on the financing front, the more things have remained the same. And last but not least, we see a lot of noise about ease of living, but very little on actual implementation on the ground. And so we'll see an election with lots of numbers being floating around, being presented to us on schemes, but probably very little real change. Thanks.
Thank you, Ms. Aiyar. I think you've raised the implementation issue quite well. I think from service delivery to regulation, the role that the central government is seeking, I think somewhere this entire talk about the cooperative federalism is getting compromised. We'll come back to these points. Now I request Mr. Shekhar Shah to give his presentation.
Thank you, Shamal. After that spirited set of comments that from Yamini about state capacity, I'm left quivering because our problems run so deep. I was given the task, or I took on the task of talking about agriculture, partly because NCER, my institution, has been working with the Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers' Welfare.